Okay, welcome back. We are going to further elaborate on the statement that was released by the so-called Arab League. You have to keep in mind Arab League has unfortunately morphed and degenerated into an organization which are all proxies and the vassal states, because they get paid so handsomely by Saudi Arabia, UAE, perhaps to some extent, and Kuwait and Bahrain to some extent, but the big fish, the big head of the snake is Saudi Arabia, which practically buys them out, and then they release the communiques that they just did, and I commented on international air. So let me just go ahead and repeat that. King, I don't want to call these people king, I have to remember that. The head of the Al Saud crime syndicate, Salman bin Abdul Aziz bin whoever hell else, he strongly criticized the Iranians for their influence in the Arab countries, saying that it violates the principle of international law and values of good neighborliness. I'm flabbergasted by such ludicrous statements. As I said on air, the prime minister, kings, the foreign ministers, did I say foreign ministers? Yeah, prime ministers, anyone who knows what's happening in the world. And the governments of the world, all of them are very well informed on what happens. Those of them who have relative sanity and knowledge, academic and scientific knowledge of what's really going on in the region, could easily argue that when it comes to Saudi Arabia, Saudi Arabia has no credibility whatsoever to talk about international law first, and two, to talk about the value of neighborliness when it's bombing the heck out of its neighbor, its southern neighbor, Yemen. During the past several years, in which they have murdered around 14,000 people, these are the numbers that political scientists are releasing right now, and there are over 100 children that are suffering from cholera, and God knows how many injured people. As I said in one of our last production, the injured people category could range from anybody who has a bruised eye to anybody who lost a limb, or anybody who's blind. It's, we have to emphasize that and focus on the fact that the injury category should be a little bit perhaps more detailed in order to point the finger at the oppressor, in this case Saudi Arabia. So this is a total diversion tactic which the Saudis are apparently learning from their Saudi cousins. I'm sorry, from the Israeli cousins, because they're so good at diverting the blame from themselves into the people that are actually killing. The Israelis are masters of manipulation, exaggeration, distortion, diversion, all these techniques. So the Saudis not being really real Arabs, and my colleagues have done excellent work in pointing out that these people are dunme. This is the correct word to describe them, D-O-N-M-E-H. I let our audience go and research what a dunme, or who are the dunmes. Let's just say these, let's just whet your appetite a little bit and say that these are migrants out of southern eastern Turkey in the 15th, 16th, and to some extent, no, we cannot say 17th century, in the 16th century, 1500s, who migrated from Turkey. They're not even Arabs, okay? They are... Should we say it, or should we just let you guys Google that, Wikipedia that? Let's just say they are the inheritance of the Sabbatean Jews of Eastern and Southern Turkey. Okay, so they are not even of ethnic Arab heritage, and now they are completely usurped the power in Saudi Arabia and are doing all the evils that they're doing, and we can no longer call these people the cousins of the Israelites. They're literally kinsmen and brothers of Israelites. They just happen to have been political opportunists, and when they were migrating south into the Arabian Peninsula, they switched their religion, they adopted this very wicked and barbaric interpretation of Islam that is called Wahhabism today by Abdul Wahhab. which was the grand theologian of them all. Very intolerant people, very against every other interpretation of Islam, you know, savagely persecuting Shia of Arabia. There's the tremendous amount of Shia in the eastern provinces of Arabia bordering Persian Gulf, where, by the way, all the oil is. And the Sufis, they have a saying that when you kill one Shia, it is as if you have killed 40 Christians, okay? In a sense that increasing the merits of the Wahhabis, especially now in Syria, calling on the death of Muslims, not to mention their butchery and their terrible attitude toward our Christian brothers and sisters. So they are not only intolerant of other interpretations and sects and denomination of Islam, they are just what the Quran calls these people takfiris. The word takfiri literally means those Muslims. The Quran is actually very generous in that. Those believers of Islam, or pretentious believer of Islam, who consider all other denominations and understandings of Islam by countries and cultures which are much more civilized and ancient than the tent dwellers of the Arabian Peninsula. And by that, of course, I'm referring to the Babylonians, I'm referring to the Assyrians, who are now perhaps called Syrian, I'm referring to the Phoenicians, who are now called the Lebanese, and most of all, I'm referring to the Persian, the great Persian Empire, and the Iranian Aryan civilization, which has been in that land for 7,000 years. Everybody quotes the 2,500 year figure. It's actually 7,000 years, because archaeologists have discovered remnants of people living in cities, which the word civilization literally comes from, in the Sistan and Balochistan region of Iran, which you could say was an offshoot of the Indus River civilization, but nevertheless Iranian and Iranic or Iranian or Aryan in ethnicity or in identity. So it's incredible to me that people whose country is not even 100 years old, Saudi Arabia was put together by the British, once again those damn British, and they became a country in 1932, and we are in 2018, so they're not even 100 years old. It's to me the height of arrogance for a country, a corrupt system, a crime syndicate of Al Saud and Abdul Aziz and all these people, these juntas, okay, I don't even want to call these people warriors, but these juntas and these tribal leaders to have become a nation, and the British were so keen on calling these people kings in order to elevate their tribal savage status. It is the height of arrogance for these people to disrespect civilization that were present in the area for thousands of years, starting with the profound Egyptian civilization, all the way to going up north to the Palestinian civilization. Let's not forget them. The Palestinians were a very civilized, organized people in Palestine, next to the Israelites who were struggling at that time. The Israelites at that time were the oppressed, and the Palestinians, according to what we read in the Old Testament, in the Torah, or the later books of the Old Testament, also in Torah is mentioned. The Jews at that time were the oppressed people, and the Palestinians were, according again to Torah, were the oppressors. But, the Saudis, to disrespect these civilizations far older than them, far more civilized, Phoenicians come in mind, as I said, the Assyrian civilization, which, by the way, were very cruel. The Assyrians, I mean, even under stone reliefs, they used to cut people's heads and ears and noses. Nevertheless, they had the city of Nineveh, which was an engineering marvel. Those of you who remember your biblical stories, Jonah, who went to the belly of a fish when he was so distraught that God decided to forgive Nineveh for their blasphemy, because as you remember, Jonah went up to Nineveh and preached the word of God, and the people in Nineveh just said, "You're right." They converted, they repented, and then changed their evil ways. In Nineveh was more or less the capital of the Assyrian Empire, which we get the word Syria from. And, you know, they converted, they decided to follow the way of God and repent and leave the evil ways behind. And Jonah was so distraught. And he's a prophet of God, okay, according to the Old Testament. So distraught that he got in a boat and wanted to go as far away from Palestine as possible. He wanted to go all the way to Iberia, which is the modern-day Spain. And a big fish came and ate them, and he was in the belly of the fish for 3 days, which is our symbol. These are symbolic languages or something much, much deeper, okay? Much, much deeper. They used the allegorical terms at that time so people could understand, the ancient people, the Iron Age people. And then he survived in the belly of the fish, he came out. My whole point is that these civilizations were much more advanced than what the Saudis have right now with their little, you know, metal toys that President Obama sold it to them in that despicable $350 billion weapons contract. Shift a little bit further to the east, you have the Babylonian civilization, a very ancient civilization, the cradle of civilization, Mesopotamia, the land of the two rivers, Tigris and Euphrates, who are called Iraqis now, and they were Arabized. And then you shift further to the east again, the great Persian Empire, which at the height of its power, extended all the way from Libya to India. I always say that because it kind of rhymes. And it's true. Libya to India, and then from the other the northern spectrum, all the way from Eurasia to Eastern Europe. Not just Greece, but further up the Greece. Macedonia comes into mind, Bulgaria, all these countries were under they were not a sphere of influence. They were literally provinces or satrapies, is the word, ancient word that's used, satrapies of the Persian Empire. So again, you know, for king this so-called king Salman to disrespect these civilizations is beyond audacious. Let's go to the next part of this production, and hopefully we'll wrap it up in that one. Thank you so much for your patience. Please stand by.